It's not easy to become an atheist. I actually went to church and Sunday school for 1,458 hours as a child from age 5 to age 18. But it wasn't until I got to college that I firmed up my atheistic beliefs.
According to Skeptic magazine, somewhere between 7 to 10% of Americans are atheists. That's over 20 million people committed to a belief in absolutely nothing divine. But remember, most atheists are thoughtful, intelligent people. Corporate executive Ralph Muncaster was one such person.
I was on the verge of becoming an atheist right before college, and I think in the back of my mind, I kind of hoped that there might be a God, but all the evidence seemed to point to there not being a God. So it really, I struggled with that issue. But after really thinking it through and rationalizing it in a logical way, the way an engineer would, I came to the conclusion that God did not exist.
After getting his degree in engineering, Ralph launched a skyrocketing career in business by landing a highly sought-after position in brand management at Procter & Gamble. And by age 30, he held the top marketing and sales position at 7-Up. A man who clearly enjoys a challenge, Ralph made a game out of challenging people's belief in God.
As long as it wouldn't hurt my business, professional career, or my family in any way, if we were in a situation and someone mentioned God or Jesus or the Bible, I made a game out of challenging them. And I would say, well, how do you know that's true? And I would ask him to defend his faith. And what I found is nobody knew how to defend their faith. It was so easy as an atheist to basically win arguments, and I thought it was kind of fun.
But for atheist Ralph Muncaster, the fun was about to end. While on a business trip, Ralph met with a supplier who gave him a challenge that changed his life.
And the supplier happened to be a, quote, Jesus freak, what I would call back then. And so he started talking about Jesus, and I started playing my game. Well, this person didn't back away. He challenged me. He said, if you spent as much time researching the Bible and Jesus Christ, you will find out that everything in the Bible is true. And I started laughing at him, and I said, no way. But we talked for a few more minutes, and I said, if you just give me a couple weeks, I will come back with some information that will so overwhelm you that you will forget this thing about Jesus in the Bible. And what that did was lead me into a research program, an intensive research program that changed my life forever.
So Ralph set out to disprove God. Not a man to waste time, he began by doing what he thought would be the easiest, discrediting the Bible.
When I was a child, I remembered seeing all these maps of Palestine and all this, and none of it seemed to make sense because it didn't agree with anything that I was being taught in school. So I thought, the first thing I'll do is prove that the history is incorrect. Well, when I started actually digging into it and going back in time in history, I found out it was absolutely correct.
When his first attempts failed, Ralph Muncaster decided it was time to get serious. He developed a logical strategy designed to determine whether or not God existed.
And I turned to statistical proof and legalistic proof, which I studied at the same time. But what really amazed me, after reading through the Bible cover to cover three times, I realized there was a vast number of prophecies embedded in the Bible. I also found out the Bible said to test everything. I also found out that the Bible said to use prophecy as a test. And when I started looking at these prophecies, I counted 668 provable historical prophecies. When I went through the statistics of these being possible, I realized that they were absolutely impossible without a God of the universe inspiring this book.
When, after years of study, he realized that the God he had openly rejected for so long was real, Ralph Muncaster's life turned around.
I sat at my desk and just thought about it for a while. And then I went in and I took a shower. And when I was in the shower, all of a sudden, I did the equivalent of getting down on your knees. I just sat down in the shower and tears started streaming down my face, which of course you couldn't see because the water was streaming down my face too. And I just said, God, I'm sorry that I have been so wrong about you and been fighting you for all these years. Just please forgive me. At that time, what I felt was a tremendous release of guilt, of some of the things I had done in the past, because after all, I'd read through the Bible a number of times, so I knew that if I believed it, truly, truly believed it, that I would be released from this guilt, and I felt a release from guilt. I was looking forward to joy in the present and also hope for the future.
After his conversion, Ralph Muncaster gave up his business career to write books and give lectures challenging other people to test for themselves the evidence for God. When we come back, we'll talk to a cultural anthropologist who found a different pathway to God.
There's no such thing as an atheist. There is only that person who is so alienated and ripped away from his or her God that they go around in anger.
When Victoria Mukherjee was a little girl, she and her mother took a whirlwind tour of the local churches every year on Good Friday. They were searching for God. At the end of the day, though, they always ended up disappointed because they didn't feel they had really connected in the way they had hoped. As an adult, Victoria studied cultural anthropology. She wanted to study the big questions and refused to accept the first answer that came her way. Her insistence on a second opinion resulted from her culturally divided upbringing.
My parents have different religions. My father is a Hindu, my mother is a Methodist. And at the time that they were raising a family, there was no community outside of our family. And there was no real consensus of who God was or what was right and wrong. I studied anthropology precisely because I had so many important questions. I have never been one to take one answer or one set of rules or one explanation for the important questions in life. So as an anthropologist, I would go and study another culture's belief system. Every religion on earth deals with the questions of man's relationship to man, man's relationship to nature, and man's relationship to God. That's what culture is about. We were put on this planet and we created these constructions of culture. We created all of them, and we created the languages in which to express them. The big question is man's relationship to God.
Victoria Mukherjee describes herself as longing to know God from the time she was a young child. For her, the turning point came when she began teaching at a Christian college in Northern California. She found what she was looking for through the confidence in God displayed by her students.
If I didn't come to class, one would call and say, Dr. Mukherjee, why aren't you here? And I'd say, well, you know, my little boy had asthma last night. And invariably, their answer would be, I'll pray for him. Whew! I just blown away by that sort of love and concern. And also, the presumption, the good presumption, that there is a God and that they can speak to him, that he will listen and that he loves them. And pretty soon, there was no way I could avoid feeling that same line of communication, experience the same loving safety of knowing God. When I first experienced God as, when I first knew God, it was like being 3 years old again and finally laying my sleepy head against the breast of my mother.
Many of Victoria's friends simply couldn't understand her decision.
The questions, the challenges that people make to me as a believer always entail the same adolescent questions. Well, what about this, and what about that, and what about the existence of this, and if there was a God, he wouldn't let this happen. Well, that's very much like a teenager who blames the whole world on his parents, just longing for that parent to take control again and to prove and to earn the respect of that rebelling child. But it's not God's place to earn our respect. It's our place to grow up, to recognize, and to worship what is absolutely good, absolutely compassionate, absolutely the truth.
The ability to worship, to kneel in genuine surrender, can be very difficult for some people. It took Victoria 40 years to find her way to her knees. She compares her story to her favorite Bible story, that of a man named Lazarus.
In the story of Lazarus, he's dead. He knows the darkness of death. He knows the coldness of the grave. When he is resurrected by Christ, he is resurrected with the knowledge of coming from that coldness, that dark grave, into the light and the love of a living God. I feel like Lazarus. Life with God is really living. Life without God is the shadow of living.